No weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work.
Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I am Pastor Agnes Williams of Agnes Williams Ministries, here again to discourse with you on principles enshrined in the Word of God. Can we just pray together? Father, we thank you, God, for this wonderful day that you have made. You are so great, God. We thank you for your blessings upon our lives. We thank you for all the things that we have passed through the year, the good, the bad, the evil, the indifferent, the glorious things. We thank you, God, for all your goodness in your life. And at this time of the end of the year, God, we praise you. We magnify your name because you are worthy of praise and there is no God like you. Thank you, God. Lord, let my mouth speak what you want me to speak today, O God, that it may edify the hearers and bring them closer to your Son, Jesus Christ. In Christ, in my prayer, thanksgiving. Amen and amen. Well, this time of the year, we call it Christmas. They call it Christmas or Xmas because it is said it was about this time that Jesus Christ was born in this season, or it was about this time that the three wise men found Jesus Christ in Bethlehem. Now, there are folks who they celebrate Christmas, but if they don't believe in Jesus Christ, why celebrate Christmas? But God's wisdom is far greater than man's wisdom. And today I'm thankful to God that he sent his Son Jesus Christ to die for our sins, to live, to be born as a child, to be nurtured in his mother's womb, born not of a man but placed there by God, to be brought up and to feel everything that we as human beings would feel. I'm sure he knew about getting his toes stomped on a stone, getting his fingers cut, maybe get a little bite by a little jaxi fly, or something like that. A thorn pricking, he went in the wrong place. He grew up as a normal child. And history has recorded that Jesus Christ was born, that he lived upon earth. He did many miracles. He died. He was placed in a tomb. He rose again from the dead. They saw him alive. His disciples saw him alive. And finally they saw him being taken up to God in a cloud in heaven, bodily. So you can shout. You can cry. You can believe, not to believe. That does not change the facts and the truth of God. That Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, came, was born as a baby. He was carried in his mother's womb for the 9 months. He grew up as a child. He was touched with the feelings of all our infirmities from childhood. He got baby teeth. He must have had teeth in pain like everybody else. He grew up. He became a young man. He had all the things a young man went through. He became a full man. And then as a full man, he was crucified on that cross to pay the price for man's sin, for man's redemption. And I truly believe it, because when you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you follow the Lord, a total change comes over your entire life. Your entire body is changed. Your mind is changed. Your thoughts are changed. Your desires are changed. You feel the new life of God springing up within you. So if you are skeptical of there, I want to challenge you today. Try Jesus. Just try following the steps that are important for you to know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Just foolishly say, these people are talking nonsense. So let me go to God, as they say, pray to their God in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ. Repent of my sins, dear Lord. I'm sorry I was born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And accept Christ into my heart. If you atheists and you agnostics out there do just that, I can guarantee you that God will wrought a magnificent change in your life that will change you from darkness to light, especially at this season of Christmas. Why do we celebrate Christmas? It's the time when they found when the wise men found Jesus Christ. They came from the different countries. They were astrologers who studied the stars, and they saw a star in the sky. And they said, this star is there. A great king is born. Let's go and see where this child is. I don't know. Nobody has ever returned from the dead to tell me that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. But we have wisdom. We have the recording, the word of God. So tonight, let me look first at Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 to 7, where they call the Old Testament as they've divided the books, where we see that Jesus Christ's birth was prophesied. Isaiah 9, from verses 6, prophesied, says here, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." So his birth was prophesied by the ancients, by the prophets who went before. God witnessed to mankind that he was going to send. And there are other prophets who prophesied that God would send a savior in the world to redeem mankind from sin. Because when Adam sinned in the Garden of Eden, man fell from grace. And God had to find a way to reconcile back man from himself. So have a way that man can repent of having sinned, repent of being born a sinner, repent of actually sinning, and ask God to forgive them of their sins and be reconciled back to God. Oh, it's so beautiful to be reconciled back to God. Such a life of peace. You have peace. The war is raging around you. Things are not as you expect, but God gives you a peace. Because Jesus Christ is the Prince of Peace. And when you accept Jesus Christ as your personal and loving Savior, and you pray to God in the name of Jesus Christ, you repent of your sins, you have a peace that passes all understanding. No amount of transcendental meditation can give you the peace that God gives. Men lie to you. They put themselves in a stupor and say they are at peace. The devil has them in a false world. But when you come to Jesus Christ, you have true peace, everlasting peace, real peace. Your body, mind, and soul, and spirit, you are really in touch with God. I've tried it. I've walked away from it for seasons in my rebellious state. And I came back to God. God stretched out his hand and he called me back to him. And I came back. And I can tell you, it is a good and glorious and godly thing to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, especially at this season we celebrate his birth. Why all this merriment at Christmas time? It's because Jesus Christ was found by the white men at this time. They searched for him, and the history say he was about 3 months old when they found him. But they followed the star from the east until they found him. They traveled from afar and they found the babe lying in a manger. I don't understand the whole semantics of the history, but the fact remains, they saw the star, they looked for the child. He was born in a manger, so it had to be him as he was just young, and they found him there. But they knew that that child was the savior of the world. That was the child that God had sent to redeem the world. These men were studying the stars and studying all what God had given unto them, and they knew that he was the Son of God. And they proclaimed it to us. Let's look at some of the things that Jesus Christ did while he was upon earth. First of all, Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 14 there, we see again where Mary became pregnant. She was engaged, or they say espoused, to be married to Joseph. She never had any dealings with him. History says that. And she found herself pregnant. God put that baby in her womb. Right? In verse 1, it talks about Jesus Christ. So, in chapter 2 of Luke, it says where they went out, there's a law to be taxed. Joseph went up. Verse 5, he went up to be taxed with Mary's espoused wife. She was great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. Verse 7 says, and she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And they were shepherds in the same country, abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone about them, and they were so afraid. And the angel said unto the shepherd, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And he said, this shall be the sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. So when the angels went over, the shepherds went to look, and they found him. They found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in the manger, just as they were told. So history usually has a record of all that has happened. And so again, I present to you Jesus. I present to you Jesus. Jesus, the Son of the Living God. Jesus, who was birthed, who was carried for 9 months in Mary's womb. Jesus, who was not born of a man, but was born of God. Jesus, whom God used to redeem mankind from sin, from the hands of Satan after Adam fell. There is record that Jesus Christ was born. Just as it's in the scripture, he was born. She never knew a man. And he was born. And I believe the word of God, because I've experienced the word of God. God has made himself real to me in many occasions. You study the word, you speak to God. Yes, you make mistakes, but you are quick to go and repent and turn away and ask God to forgive you. Because the Bible says the blood of Jesus Christ will never lose its power till all the ransomed church of God are saved to sin no more. There's a great day coming. Look around you in the world. See what's happening. See how the world is going from corruption to deeper corruption to greater corruption in all aspects. Now they want to have a new world order. The Bible speaks about those things if you search the scriptures. They want to have a new world order, that they can control humanity, control who is born, control who lives, control who dies. But mark my word, the word of God says, God is going to return with his son, Jesus Christ, to deliver those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, to rapture and to take away those who have accepted Christ, repented of their sins and are trying to live for him. And then you'll leave the rest of the world to suffer the punishment that God would give to man for refusing the sacrifice of his son, Jesus Christ, to cleanse man from sin and to reconcile man back to God. I always ask the question, has anyone ever returned from the dead and told you what is after death? Few people have seen some of those things. But God says you have the prophets, Moses and the prophets, hear them. You have the word of God, study that. So, some of your loved ones have gone, they've died. Have they come back and told what's beyond there? No, because God laid down the pattern. And if we cannot believe earthly things, we cannot believe heavenly things. If you cannot believe the word sent by the prophets and his servants, if you cannot believe the word of God, Jesus Christ is the only man who died and God raised him from the dead, took on to redeem man. There is no other one. The Bible says there is no other name under heaven, upon earth, whereby we must be saved. And these are scrolls that were written by men. And there are some hidden scrolls in the world that mankind is hiding from man. And if those scrolls were revealed, our God is an awesome God. He made the whole universe. He made different types of creatures, the other planets. And then he decided, I'm going to make man. I'll make something called man. I'll make him in my own image, my own likeness, and I'll deal with him. So you can jump high or jump low. At the point of death, will you be ready to ask to be with God or away from him? You can scream, you can write all your thesis, you can make all the declarations, but the word of God abides forever and stands forever. It has stood the test of time, and it will stand the test of time. When we are gone, when you are gone, you can't come back and tell anybody, well, I'm not with the Lord. I'm in hell, suffering damnation and hellfire, and where the worm died not. Hey, I believe the word of God. If I can believe a part of the word and it came true, I can believe the whole word. We believe other men who write books. We believe all different theses. And then the people who have discovered all the scientific things, it's God who gave them the wisdom to discover them. Almighty God rules, and he sent his son, Jesus Christ. That's why we celebrate Christmas. Some people call it Xmas. Call it what you want. The fact remains, we celebrate something, and we know what, I know what we celebrate. We celebrate that Jesus Christ came as the Son of the living God, as a babe, to live upon earth, to feel all that a man would feel, all the infirmities, all the illness. He grew up as a child, everything, that he can be a worthy representative of us to God the Father. So today I want to tell you once more, Jesus Christ is indeed the Son of the living God. Jesus Christ was born. He lived as a child. He lived as a young man. He lived as a full man. But he was God and man in one being. History records, he died on the cross for our sins. They crucified him. They had to do it. Thank God you and I weren't the ones to do it. But it had to be done by someone. And when they crucified him and they buried him, he rose again from the dead. There is ample proof that God raised him from the dead. No man raised him from the dead. He was raised from the dead by God. When they rolled away the stone, there was nobody, he wasn't there. God, who is almighty, raised him up and took his body out of that tomb, glorified. And now we say that Jesus Christ, the Bible says, where is he? He's at the right hand of God his Father, constantly making intercession for man, that man would be saved. That's his work. He's our great intercessor right now. He's our great intercessor before God, pleading for us. He pleads for you and me that God would forgive us when we choose to repent, that God would have mercy. But there's going to come a time when either you and I die or the Lord returns to earth, as the Lord has prophesied, to take back his people and to destroy the earth and make a new heaven and new earth. Trust me, man that is born of woman is eternal. Your flesh will die, but the God part of your spirit will never die. And where will you live when you die? In the spirit will derail you. Will you live with the devil and his angels in hell with torment? Or will you live Jesus Christ and God in his eternal home? What they call heaven, but his eternal home, away from torture, away from sin, in a glorious home. Oh, what a wonderful hope we have. What a wonderful hope we have. Jesus is the reason for the season. Jesus is the reason for the season. The season that we call Christmas time. He is the reason for the season. Sometimes they put Xmas, because they call him Mr. X. They don't want to admit that he is Jesus. Whatever you do, the fact remains that Jesus Christ was born. He lived. He died. He rose again, as was prophesied by the prophets of old, and as was recorded in the book. And they saw him bodily. In Acts chapter 1, we see where the disciples, he said he was going to leave them, and they were with him. And in Acts chapter 1, we see here that he was with the disciples after he rose from the dead. He visited them many times. God allowed him to visit them many times to teach them and to console their hearts and to know that he was the Son of God, and that God had done what he said he was going to do, and God is all powerful, and anything that God says he will do, he did it. And he came out to his disciples, and they were assembled together with them. And then he spoke with them, he encouraged them. And Acts 1 chapter 9 says, and when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and the cloud received him out of their sight. And verse 10 says, and while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel. Verse 11, he said unto them, ye men of Israel, of Galilee, why stand you gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. So his birth was prophesied, and he was born the way he said. His death was prophesied. His lifestyle was prophesied, because he said he's going to heal many people and bring many to salvation. He was taken up to heaven as he was prophesied. And if all those things have been accomplished, why is it so impossible for the last point to be accomplished when they said he will come back again to take up his own? Brethren, hear us. Jesus is the reason for the season that we are celebrating now, Christmas time. All the celebrations, everything, it's because Jesus Christ was born. And heathen men, evil men, though they don't want to believe in Jesus Christ, they are forced to celebrate his birth at this time. Oh, the merchants make money, it's profitable for them. But God is using that to show that they have to bow still. They make their money on Christmas, okay, it's Christmas time. The people celebrate, we buy turkey, we buy black cake, we buy clothes, we give gifts, we do all sorts of things. The fact remains that Almighty God allows mankind to still celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ, because God is God all by himself, and he is almighty, and all his words have come true in the past, and they will come true in the future. So I exhort you today, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, get the Holy Scriptures, the Holy Bible, study it, read it for them. The Bible says, search the Scriptures. Jesus Christ said, they are which speak of him, of me, which was him. And see for yourself. I can guarantee you, if you study the Bible as it's written and search the Scriptures, at the end of your search, I can guarantee you that the Spirit of God will speak to you. You will become enlightened and you will understand the truth of God's word, and you will repent of your sin and turn your life over to Jesus Christ. So at this time of the year, I challenge you, if you're an agnostic, you're an atheist, you're an unbeliever, you're a non-Christian, you don't believe in Christ, try reading the whole Bible through. Study it like you study geography and the stars, astronomy. Study medicine, study it. And I know that at the end of your studies, you will then understand that there is a God, that God made man. God sent his son Jesus Christ to live and to die. And God has redeemed us, and he's coming back again, as he said, to take up his redeemed people, and those who have rejected him will be away from him. Not that God wants to do that, but God has given us a choice. It is our choice as man, our choice as mankind, to decide, do we want to accept God's gift of his son Jesus Christ, or do we want to believe all the other foolishness and live in our sin and debauchery? And when we die in that state, we are away from God. Think about it. Jesus is the reason for the season. Whether you believe it or not, I declare, the word has declared it, God has declared it. Jesus is the reason for the season. Let's bow our hearts in prayer. Father, we thank you. I thank you, God, for the opportunity one more time to present Jesus Christ to your people, God. I pray, God, some heart somewhere, oh God, would turn to you, would accept Christ as their Savior, and be redeemed from sin and from the hands of Satan, and could be guaranteed eternal life once they still depart me. Thank you, God. Bless your name. Thank you in Jesus' name. From Pastor Agnes Williams of Agnes Williams Ministries, wishing you all a Merry Christmas, a bright and prosperous new year, and a new year where you have found Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you can live to please Almighty God. Thank you.
No weapon formed against me shall prosper.